mad kitchen, boy.
Back at it again. People just don't understand what really comes with these vehicles. Like, yeah, so little dudes, they tried to steal my car last night, but they didn't even know I was watching them. I'm literally watching them. I'm watching y'all about to take my car. Like, not gonna happen on my watch. Like, I've always said, you know, if my car is somewhere and you try to take, you do that. Okay, that's that. But if I'm right there and I'm watching, it's not going down like that at all. And it sucks. It really does. Because I always have mixed emotions owning a 392 as far as getting rid of it or keeping it. Or also getting another Mopar product. Because I do love Trackhawks. And I do love Hellcat Challengers. But it's like, dang, man. I don't know. Because deep down, I'll always love how these cars perform, how they sound. They do what I need them to do, and they fit my driving style. Like, the car is not going to let you down. It's going to run. As long as you do all your maintenance and everything, these motors are dang near bulletproof. But is it worth dealing with all the stupidity and stupid, unnecessary, close calls? Like, the situation that happened last night, my car is parked, right? So I'm inside. I'm looking outside. You know, as being a Mopar owner or any muscle car or any nice car, performance or anything, if someone's passing you, whether you're inside a home, inside of a gas station, inside of any place, if they see a car, people tend to hit the gas. So you're gonna be like, you're gonna look around like, dang, where'd that come from? But they only did that because they seen your car. And I know other people experience this all the time. So I kept hearing the same vehicle come by. And me, I know cars, I know exhaust sound, I know all that. So I don't even have to, for example, I don't have to hear a car and I'll know it's a RT Charger or a RT Challenger, any form of 5.7. I know just by the ear. Of course, you can tell a Hellcat because it's going to whine, but I know a 392 sound as well. And I know the difference from a 15 to 18 392 sound or a 19 to 23. That's just how cold I am when it comes to, you know, breaking down the analytics of what I just heard. That's how cold I am. And so I kept hearing this car, which they were in a all black Chrysler 300, blacked out. It looked like a 2012 300S. You see, I know my stuff. So like, I'm not gonna forget stuff. Like, come on now. So I go to look out and I see a dude standing right in front of my car. Mind you, I parked to where somebody was behind me. So you can't come behind me and push my car. And in front of me, of course, it was just open right there. But you're not supposed to park in front of me because where it was, it's like a bus stop right there. So no one should be blocking the bus stop. I'm behind the side where I'm in the clear. So I move a certain way on purpose. I did what I did for a reason. So one, you shouldn't be parked in front of me. Two, why is this dude standing in front of my car? And on top of that, mind you, he's wearing a Pusheisty mask. So whenever these situations like this happen, I've had this a few times now. So you don't never just run out in the blind. Hey, what you doing? No, that's not how you do it. You sit back, You peep the scene first, because a lot of times they're not going to be alone. So they'll set up somebody right there, but they have somebody either, you know, around the corner or in a spot where you wouldn't see them if you just bust out the door and come out, you know, crazy. So I just let it play on. And he stood in front of my car for a good 2 to 3 minutes. I'm just watching him. He don't even know I'm looking. So I'm like, oh, yeah, I see what they own. And then he's just watching each car coming, watching. And the last time he looked to the left, that's when I seen he had the mask on. Ain't nothing else to talk about. I already knew what was going on. So it wasn't nothing else to think. I already knew. So he waited for one more car to come past. And he motioned to go towards my car. I said, no, I'm not about to get hit with another $300, you know, getting a new window and having to get it tinted again. So I hurry up and hit that remote start button. Boop. I hit it so quick. And in the midst of me hitting the remote start, getting my coat and stuff so I can go outside. Mind you, it was cold where I am right now. So I had to get my jacket. Because I'm like, all right, I'm about to go outside. So after I hit that button, got my jacket, got my shoes, I had everything on. Had my pole. I'm watching him. So little dude, he goes and gets in the back left side of the car. So mind you, that means there's a person in the driver's seat, a person in the front passenger seat, a person on that side that he was on in the back. So he's right there. So that's four people right there. It could be a fifth person. See what I'm saying? So you got to move a certain way. When I come out, I have to do what I have to do. And over a dang car. It's just not worth it, bro. But like, dang. This is the car you want. Like, you should be able to work hard by the car you want and enjoy it, not have to worry about people coming to steal it just because they want it. Or to get some money off of it. Party. Or to sell it as a striker. People do that all the time. But what I just had to fix my mind on, it's not personal to me. So it's not like no one is specifically coming saying, hey, we want to take his car. We want to take B-Wayne's car. It's just more of a, dang, that mug hot. We about to get this mug. So I just do that for, you know, your mental. It's not about you. It's just, they just want your car. Because if you get in your head and think that they're targeting you, that could make you do some things that you don't need to do just over the car. If you get what I'm saying, you can read in between the lines. Like, you know, some people know what I'm talking about. If you don't, you know, just put it together. So by me thinking like that, I don't really think nothing of it. But if I come out and I catch you, that's a totally different ball game. But it's just like, dang, I'm doing this over this car. Like, you know, I believe in, you know, just watching what you say and everything. So I'm not really going to say what I want to say. But anyone who knows me personal knows pretty much how I would think about this situation. But I'm just telling you things, you know, from an aspect of being safe and doing things within your law boundaries. You know, some states are stand your ground and some are not. I, you know, stay in the stand your ground state. But even though you do, you still need to be careful and think things out first. Don't just do stuff, you know, really think things out. And once you've been through certain situations, it's really nothing to think about. It's more of a muscle memory type of thing. So it's not nothing like where you have to think. Well, for me personally, I already know it's go time. And it's just that. I mean, these people are coming. They're masked up 4 or 5 deep. You know they're not coming empty handed. You don't know. They might have switches. They all type of guns. Dracos, ARPs. So you really can't play around. So you have to be ready for that. You really do. and be very careful. Like, if you're a person, you know, you don't like conflict or you're not prepared for the conflict, I wouldn't even say, you know, come face first in this situation. No, just let it play out how it's going to play out and call insurance, because any minor inconvenience as far as like hesitation or being skeptical or not being aware of what's really about to happen, this car is not worth your life. Don't even try it. No, do not. It's not worth it. Because these young dudes out here, they'll pop you over it. And, you know, it's really not worth it. Even if you have to pop someone over these cars, if you're not in a stand your ground state, or maybe they did something that, you know, people would say like, well, they weren't harming you, they were just doing something to the car. Now you got yourself in a sticky situation. Then, you know, you're going to have lawyer fees. You got to take that trip downtown. On top of that, even if you have to pop somebody and you're in the right, let's say they tried to rob you for your 392 or your cat, the people don't care. Now they won't get back. You know what I'm saying? So it doesn't just end at you popping someone and you get self-defense. That's not the case at all. Depending on who his people are and what they want to do, they might try to get some get back. That's all I'm trying to tell you. Over a car, not a personal situation, not you did something today, people, or nothing. Just because they got, you know, they took the asphalt challenge because they wanted to steal something. So this is what you really have to deal with. Now, if the only time I will recommend from now on, this point of day, for someone to get one of these cars is if you can literally be okay with bringing it out just to have fun, or you're going from A to B, like from your house to a family member's house, or from, you know, there to work back, you know, where it's going to be put up. Like, as far as getting out on the weekend, going to a bar, going to a concert, going to stuff like that, this ain't the car for that. Now, you might get away with it for a while, but all it takes is one time for things to go bad. It's not worth it. That's all I can tell you, because, you know, I don't really want to go say nothing too crazy, because I don't agree with, you know, thieves and things of that sort. And there's probably a lot of people who agree with me. But at the same time, you know, I understand what this platform can do and how many people I can touch around the world that I'll probably never even meet, like different parts of the world, like in Africa, you know, just it literally anywhere. I have people in New Zealand, all parts of the world that watch my channel. So, and they're different ages. So, you know, there's young people, there's old people, there's some in between. And I don't want to skew people's mind to, if something is happening to their vehicle, to possibly hurt someone or in someone's life because of something I've said. What I'm telling you is just to be very careful, because someone can do that to you. That's all I'm trying to say. I don't condone in violence, and I don't want you to do that to someone. But if your life is in danger, you have the right to protect yourself. You know, you're just playing defense. That's all I'm trying to say. And it really sucks, because these cars give you an experience that no other vehicles do, just because you get that raw, you know, horsepower sound and experience from these engines. That's probably the second or third time with the situation I had last night that made me feel like, you know, I don't want this car no more, even though it's my favorite car. But as far as the back end, as far as like, you could potentially have to stand on business and protect yourself, your property, and your family just over this car. And it puts you in a situation like, man, I can get another car, bro. Like, I can get any car I want. It's not worth me having to do what I, you know, over this car. I really hate that feeling. And the fact that you know these dudes are willing to risk their life to have a little come up. Man, I just shake my head sometimes. Like, bro, you can get the same stuff if you just grind, you just get your credit right, you just work hard, have your discipline, you know, work six, seven day weeks if you have to, sacrifice all that partying, drinking lean, smoking. You can get you a scatter cat and not even have to steal it, not even have to put yourself in a harm's way where somebody might Willie Manchester you and hit you in the back with that double barrel shotgun, you know, or that 12 gauge, get hit like Ricky. It's not worth it. Because, you know, some of these people have long lives ahead of them. Like, you see these little 17-year-olds, sometimes people younger coming to steal these cars. Like, I seen the little dude that was standing outside my car. He's probably like 5'5". I'm like, look at this little dude. But you don't underestimate nobody, because in the streets, people have the ultimate equalizer, which are guns. Like, it doesn't matter if you're 4'11". A person that's 6'8" better respect you, because if not, you have the ultimate equalizer, and it's going to even the fight as if you're 7 foot, even if you're 4'11". So you just have to know how to move. You have to know in your brain, what are you going to do when it's crunch time? Are you going to give it up? Are you going to protect it? Or are you going to try to get up out of that situation? And that's really what you have to train your brain for. Because if you don't, you're going to get caught off guard. They're going to have the element of surprise on you if you're not peeping the scene. And then you'll be screwed. You don't want nothing to happen to you. You don't want nothing to happen to your family. Now, if somebody damages your vehicle, okay, that's fine. You can fix it or get a new one. But something happening to you or your family is nothing you want to deal with. In terms of that, the only vehicles that could ever make up for how... the only vehicles that even come close to making me feel like... give you the rush that the 392 and the cats do... or I say the CTSV does, the Z06 Vet, and the ZL1 Camaro. But even with in the GT500, but even with all those vehicles, the Dodge is always going to be the rawest muscle car. You know, the most, you know, buck wild, crazy rush like that. Some of these vehicles are more tamed. To where, yes, it's still fast. It's over 650 horsepower, but it's more calm with the, you know, you don't really have to worry about breaking loose, especially in a ZL1. For the most part, with traction on, it might slip maybe a little bit, but it's going to lock in and it's going to go and it's going to handle like it's on rails. Now, the Z06 gets bug wild and is dangerous. Like, the Vets are all motor. I'm talking about a C7 Z06. That's a very, you know, a monster type of car. But when you get into the SSs and the ZL1s, they're more, those are sports cars. So they're focused on performance, let alone with the muscle. Dodge is straight out muscle. Not worried about going around corners and turns, even though these Chargers and Challengers can handle better than what people think. The best Mopar out of all of them, I feel, is the Trackhawk. And right along with that is the Durango Cat. But I like the Trackhawk the best because you're feeling all of the horses. So, for example, you know, I drive a 392 Charger. I drove a wide-body Hellcat. You know, I tested that out. You know, went some nice speeds in Mexico. And, of course, I rode in the track. Like, 2-3 different times I've been in Trackhawks. I've been in one that was modded and one that was stock. And even the stock Trackhawk is more fun than a Hellcat Charger or Challenger. wait, the Trackhawk is a whole nother game when you're feeling all that power through all four wheels. It's different. Now, of course, the Challenger and Charger can go a little faster. You can get 180 out of a Trackhawk or Durango Cat. But as the different element with the Chargers and Challengers, you can wiggle around a lot. You can slide around corners. You can do donuts. But now you can pull a fuse in the track and do donuts in the Trackhawk. But who wants to mess their four-wheel drive up, their all-wheel drive up? I wouldn't recommend it. You can tear some stuff up. But if you want to, you technically could do burnouts in Trackhawks. So, yeah. It's a difference with that all-wheel drive for sure. This is just my message for y'all. I hope y'all can learn from me and get in your brain that you have to be safe in these cars. Like, comment, subscribe, hit that notification bell. I'm out. Peace.